sheep could see far. It was a phenomenal thing. We backed the things up and we watched a couple of things about how phenomenal. There's never been anything brighter in the sky than this spectacle of Jupiter converging with Venus. And all stargazers and all people who study stars see this is the brightest thing that has ever appeared in the heavens. And of course, it appeared on December 25th. We know that because we backed up all the stars and all that stuff, and we've gone into that. But right in the midst of that, something was more glorious than that. Angels appeared. Angels hadn't appeared for 400 years. Do you realize how significant that is? And the angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them. Whose angel was it? Who had just been birthed? What comes with the birthing of something from God? Angels. And this particular one that revealed himself, he was an angel of the Lord. And suddenly stood there before them. And what else took place? The glory of the Lord shone around them. They hadn't seen the glory of the Lord since the tabernacle. And the glory of the Lord is there. Not the glory of the angel. Why? Because the Lord had just been birthed. The earth is now in connection with the Lord that came from heaven, and his glory is already beginning to be poured out upon the earth. Why? Because something substantial has happened. Not only has the Savior showed up, but you realize angels didn't recognize him as the Savior. They recognized him as the King. And they're connected to him because he's the King. He was from ancient times. He was the one that commanded things to be made. And he's the one, the Scripture says, made the earth and made the heavens. And he's the one that holds all things. And so they come and they had just seen him in the form of maybe some residue of Melchizedek. And now we're looking at him in a different form. But that's who he's going to be. And it's just going to be a short while before he's doing it. Meanwhile, that's my Lord. I'm his angel. There's one of his angels standing here on earth. But not only is there his angel standing on earth, there's something else. The angel said to him, "Don't be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news, great joy, which will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, there has been born a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Now, we know that story, right? Anybody not heard that story? You've been saturated up your eyeballs with that. "This will be a sign for you. You'll find a baby wrapped in," most scripture says, "swaddling clothes," which we discovered those were grave clothes, strips of cloth that you raise a body with, or wrap a body with, and he was laying in a manger. "Suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying," you realize there had not been a multitude of heavenly hosts appear in 1,000 years. Now the heavens are open. There's something substantial that's taking place here. Something has happened because there's a whole host. Now, I don't know how many that is, but it numbers, in my opinion, it says there's a whole host of angels that worship Jesus in the heavens when he shows up on the throne. How many is that? I'm telling you, it's a bunch. It's more than can be counted. And there's also all kinds of other creatures. There's a wheel in the wheels. There's a seraphim. I can just go on and on. There's a whole list in Scripture that gives us of spiritual creatures that we don't understand, nor do we know what they do, but they're part of the heavens. But then there's also the angels. And it's just been opened. And the shepherds are beholding something that is opened in the sky that hadn't been opened in 1,000 years. The presence of the Lord descended upon the temple, the new temple, when it was built. With him always comes his entourage. Remember, he stayed there in that temple until, of course, they turned against him. That was some 400 years later. When they turned against him, the whole country, and they put all these other gods right in his court, the Scripture gives us a record, Ezekiel does, of God rising up off of his throne, because he had had enough, There was 35 other statues of gods that were in the courtyard, and his priests were worshiping those gods before they came in. And the women were outside the courts crying for Tumez, the sun god. And God rose up, according to Scripture. He looked out the door, went to the threshold of the temple, and said no more. And he began to rise. And he told one of the angels with him, go take a coal from the altar and disperse it over them. And the wheels parted like a new dimension. And inside they went into the tabernacle of God and got one of the coals of fire of judgment. And that angel cast it over Israel, and judgment hit them. And God rose up. And the last place he was seen by the prophet was right over, where, Bethany? Right over Bethany, where Jesus would make his entry. Now, I'm sure you all know that story and realize that. But there are some celestial things going on here, connection with angels. And this is a depiction of some of those things happening. You see that? It's like a doorway that all of a sudden has been established here on earth. That doorway was established the second Jesus was born on earth. We'll take a little bit more of that. Now, took you through one scene, and I'm going to tie them together at the end so I don't lose you. I realize we're in the middle, so don't fall off the camel. Let's go to the end, and we'll tie the two together. Bethel, house of God. Something substantial happened there. Remember Jacob? He was being chased by his brother Esau. He's running from Esau, and he's in trouble. He has stolen the birthright, which in Esau's eyes, his father was going to give away a double portion of everything to Esau, and that the younger brother was supposed to end up with only like a third. But the younger brother was going to be crowned king over the entire family, over everything that was there. But instead, Jacob went in, put goat skin on his hand, his mother helped him, and father reached in, and, oh, it's you, but your voice, you know, it sounded girly-like, and, oh, well, yeah, dad, it's me. Yeah, I sure found that deer quick. Oh, yeah, God is on my side. He said, your God. Your God helped me. Your God. That was his mindset. It was not his God. It was Jacob's God. Excuse me. It was Abraham's God. No, Isaac's God. It was somebody's God. One of them guys. Okay, you figure it out. So here he is. He's running. Now, if you ever steal something, you realize that his brother was a hunter. Not a good idea to steal something from somebody who's a hunter. And he's being looked for. His brother is coming to kill him, and his brother is in charge of everything. In fact, when he meets him some years later, he's got about 300 to 600 men with him. He's got his own little private army, inherited an army from Abraham to Isaac, and now Esau is got the army, and remember the army that Abraham had of 318 trained men, it multiplied. That little army went and took down an army of over 10,000. Why? Because angels again entered in. So we have a man that's laying there, and he comes to, now Jacob, this is Genesis 28 and 10. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it under his head. Tough pillows back then. And he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth. And its top reached to the heaven. There's your ladder. That's the earth. It was set up on the earth. It was just not something that was leaned up. It's something that was attached to. It was permanently set up. And it reached into the heavens. It was the bridge. And there the angel of God were ascending and descending upon it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, where was the Lord standing? Above it. Anybody want to climb the ladder and see what's above it? Behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac, and the land which you lie, I will give to you and to your descendants. You realize who was supposed to receive that? Esau. But Esau, he spit in God's face. He didn't want anything to do with God. He thought God was a big joke. Traded God for a bowl of soup. Genesis 28:15, behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Something going on here. The heavens have opened. God on the top of the ladder is looking right down at him. Evidently, he can see him because God's speaking to him and said, first of all, I want to give you my presence. I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. Sound familiar? Second of all, I want to extend to you, if you will stay in my presence, my protection. Do you need his protection? Do you see what's at the bottom of the ladder? You think we need to learn some more about the ladder? I guess we're not going to. There we go. Psalms 91:11. For he will give his angels charge concerning you to guard you in your ways. Do you accept that as carte blanche from God? Which means there are angels that are here, just like we accept the fact that there are demonic forces. Those are fallen angels that serve Satan and come to take us out of the way of God, to speak into our minds and into our thinking so that we get out of the way of God. But here, God has sent his angels, giving charge concerning, to guard your ways, to make sure your way stays in his way. We need that because we got this outside influence. And we're not supposed to pray to angels, and we're not supposed to chat up angels and all that stuff, although I have chatted up a couple in my lifetime, and I can tell you that you have too. Why? Because it says that they're going to come and visit, and we're not going to be aware of it. And if God says they're going to visit, we're not going to be aware of it, that means you already had a visit. And it was to help us into God's right, to help us, to bring us into light. It was help us, bring us into the foot of the ladder where we can say, oh my goodness, there's something going on here. And that's exactly what Jacob did. He woke up from his sleep and said, oh, surely the Lord is in this place and I didn't know it. So with the ladder and with the scene and with the angels, we have something that took place. He became aware. But also, we find out, he said he's afraid. How awesome is this place? And none other than the house of God and what? The gate of heaven. Do we need to find that? Before you die, you need to find that. Because if you don't find the gate of heaven, if you don't get in the house of God, you won't find the gate of heaven, because the house of God is his church. He formed the house of God. And in the midst of that, that's where we're supposed to find the gate. So Jacob was made aware in the midst of this church meeting. This is one of the first church meetings. Why? Because it was called the house of God. We'll find out it's church meeting, especially at the end. They take up an offering. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord's in this place. And we read that. Let's go on here. Jacob arose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put his head on and set it as a pillar and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of the place Bethel, house of God. But he also called it the gate. So we have God establishing his house. What was it? It was a rock. And what is Jesus? Jesus is my rock. And what was God to the people? It was a rock that was unapproachable. Remember the mountain? And God is known as the rock that was unapproachable. The rock had to be established first. God saying, my face is fixed, my ways will not change, you need to conform to my ways. We needed to see the rock so that we could see the pattern and see how we didn't live up to the pattern, because we needed somebody to help us get in a position that we could know him. So the first church is established. It's a place of meeting. Matter of fact, Jacob came back here, and you remember this is where he wrestled with Jesus years later. He came back with his wife and camels and herds and all that stuff from Laban's house, and he had another encounter. He had grabbed hold of Jesus from the angel, and he wouldn't let go. Wouldn't let go. Although he didn't know him, he wouldn't let go. There's some of you that don't know the fullness of who Jesus is, but all I can tell you is don't let go. Wrestle to know him. Fight to know him. We're not fighting him. We're fighting ourselves. We're fighting our will to go do our own thing and live our own life and raise up our own ways. But we don't have to pay attention. But he made this statement. Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and keep me in this way that I am going, and give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, that I may come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. All of a sudden he went from God being his father's God to now God being his God. And where was it happening at? It was happening at the foot of the ladder. It was happening in the house of God. I've met a lot of people that say, well, I found Jesus outside the church, but yet they don't go to church, yet they don't live like Christ, yet they don't know him, they don't walk with him, they don't look like him, they don't act like him, they don't smell like him, and I don't know, we're going to stand in front of a judgment throne. We better look like him, act like him, and smell like him to identify with him. And of course, I know they received it. A lot of false teachings, no doubt, from Origen, because that's something that Origen also taught, and a lot of other false teachers taught. He became resolved to make God his God, which points out we need to make a resolve to make God our God. And the stone which I have set as a pillar shall be God's house. You know that to be Jesus. I already told you that. Jesus is a rock. End of the church meeting. And of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. Now, we're not passing the plate again. But I want you to know there was an encounter with the real Jesus there. So how can we get into that position? How can we get into the position of a real encounter with him? Well, it's something that Jesus came, that baby came to establish. Now, we're going to start and shift our story now into the New Testament. We're going to start with Nathanael. Jesus, this is in John 1:47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, whom there is no deceit or no guile. And Nathan said to him, how do you know me? Jesus answered and said to him, Philip, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, see, Philip was one of Jesus' disciples. He'd gone to Nathanael. Nathanael's response is, is there anything good thing that can come from Nazareth? Something you might not know about him. He was about 25 at this time. He was known to be quite the philosopher. Well-educated man. Him and Judas were the most well-educated men of all the disciples. Judas hated him. Judas, the deceiver. Nathanael, pure of heart. Not a thief. If you dropped a coin, he would, this is yours. If he held a coin for 6 months, he would look for the owner of it. There was no deceit in him. But Jesus, who is God, was evidently watching Nathanael in and under the trees. What was Nathanael doing that got Jesus' attention? That Jesus said, I heard you or knew you when you were standing under the trees. I would submit to you that Nathanael was there crying out, "Oh God, I want to know you. Oh God, I long for you." Because Jesus makes a comment that just absolutely shook Nathanael up. He said, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you're the Son of God." Why? Because he was having a God experience in that under the tree. And Jesus, who's at the top of the ladder, he's looking down and he sees what Nathanael is calling out. And he makes the statement. Two things were revealed from him to him. But evidently he was talking to God of how much help he needed, how much transformation he needed, how wicked he was. He was confessing all those things and realizing his need and realizing the king needed, that Israel needs a change and it needed a king because he needed a king over him. Because that was, you are the Son of God and you are the King of Israel. Those two things had to be what happened under the tree. But Jesus answered and said, "Because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, you believe in me?" Oh, I wished our faith was that simplistic. He says, "You'll see greater things than these." Remember, what was it predicated on? It was predicated on Jesus having seen and Jesus revealing himself now and saying, "I see you." You know, Jesus is ready to have a conversation with you and says, "I see you. I see you when you asked me this the other day. I know when I can hear you knocking." When I was praying about this message, and at 12:01, not last night, but the night before, when I needed to get some sleep and to get ready for Proverbs, it woke me up. Here, we're staying in our camper, for those of you who don't know, because our house is a shambles. I heard that on the front door. It woke me up. And I thought, is somebody there? And the Lord spoke and said, "No, I need to speak with you. I need to speak with you." I'm expecting him to speak to me. I'm expecting him to walk with me. I've made him my God. Money's not my God. Nothing in this life is my God. He is my God. It's taken me a while to get there. But a few years. I received Jesus some 55 years ago. I've been walking with him in the Spirit some 40 plus years. Lots of bumblebee dances. Lots of roller coasters. But he's real. And he's my God. And he's promised to protect me. He's promised to make provision for me. He's promised to lead the way. He's promised to be my God. Here's what Jesus said. If we will do what he did, what Nathanael did, it's just simple. He said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Do you realize what kind of statement that is? Jesus is making a statement. This is what you'll see with your eyes, Nathanael. Because you want to see me as a Savior, the Son of God. You want to see me as your personal King. And since you want to see me, and there's no guile in your heart, it's not for any reason, it's just because you want to know me. I would submit to you, Jesus spoke this then. I would submit to you, at Jesus' birth, the gate opened. At Jesus' birth, the angels burst forth out of the heavens. At Jesus' birth, everything was established for us. And we were invited into the house of bread to know him. At Jesus' birth, the ladder was established, and we're here on this earth. And if we can stay at Jesus' feet, we will have encounters with our Lord and with our Master from above. You can expect to see Him. You can expect to hear Him. If we're in Jesus, and the Scripture says that He is this ladder that the angels descend and ascend on, if we're in Him, aren't the angels going to be climbing right past? Now, I grant you, we're on the earth. But have you made it to that first rung yet? Stepping off planet Earth with all your desires and wants and lusts and must-haves and safety programs for retirement and safety of life and I've got to get myself in this position. Have you got loose from those where you can step up on that run? Because see, the higher we go on that ladder, the more that we will see of our God, and the more we will have experience with Him. Jesus established that on His birth. He set on this earth this ladder or this set of stairs where we can have spiritual experience, and we can't have it anyplace else. That's why we come to the house of God, to set at the ladder. To set, okay, are you going to pour out on? Okay, we're one of your angels. We want to see you, Lord. It's a significant thing to see an angel or be directed by him, but it's a more significant thing to be directed by your Lord. And the Lord wants you to get into the revelation that Jesus established and opened up that stairway, that we can have heavenly experiences with our living God. How is it, do you think, that so many people in the New Testament church give account of having experience with him? Paul had an experience with him on the road to Damascus. Jesus, standing on the stairway, came down and stood on the earth. Why? Because the Scripture says that the ladder extended and was set up upon the earth and extended into the heaven. He's still our only gate. But not only is there a gate for our survival upon our death, He is the only gate for us to have relationship with our living God. And in the midst of that, we should be having relationship with all of His celestial beings. I remember when I was 5 years old, maybe 4 and a half, sitting on a swing, because I told you about the story that we were dirt poor. We lived in a motel court in Carlsbad, New Mexico that had probably been built in the 20s. And this was in the 50s. No pavement around, dirt. Hadn't had much to eat that month. Remember my mom got a box of oats? I said, oh. Remember saying, oh, praise God, look at this. God provided for us this week. We can stretch this out. It's so big, we can stretch it for a month. Remember her unzipping the top of that and pulling out one of those Green Depression goblets. But she had just got through talking about the treasures of God, how much He loves us, and how He will provide for us. And she pulled out of that green goblet, and she said, oh, my goodness. Here, son, this is just for you. Now, I took it that it was Jesus materialized that. It was a big emerald glass to me. I know, I'm foolish. I saw it, and I went out, and I jumped in the swing set, and I just started swinging and singing to the Lord. Songs burst forth from my heart. I was singing, and this is the New Mexico, and there were some big thunderheads that were building. And as I was singing, my heart's desire to praising Him, and my mom's not Pentecostal. Clouds parted, and right in between there was a golden rim that flashed down, and I could see the heavens, and I could hear the angels and the heavenly host singing. And I joined in with their singing, as a good Baptist would. Not having been told that that can't happen, probably 45 minutes to an hour, I couldn't leave the scene. I swung and swung and swung, and the clouds parted more, and it's like I could see angels looking over. It was real. Heavens were open, because I believed my Lord. I believed in Him. I thanked Him for the simple provision of a glass. I thanked Him for the simple provision of just a box of oats that we could live on. If we become thankful to Him and we seek after Him with all of our heart, shouldn't we expect experience with Him? Because I tell you, you can get into some awful dead religion without experiencing Him. It's just dead. You can read the Bible all you want, but if you don't experience Him, it's dead. Jesus is what's living. Jesus wants to walk in our midst and lead us. Walk in our midst. Give us His counsel. Walk in our midst and become our protector. Walk in our midst and reveal Himself. And the ladder is still up, but few realize what Jesus brought to the face of this earth and attached to it permanently until His return. And every one of us can run to His church if He's there. If He's withdrawn, it's just a social club. Jesus is not interested in social events. He's interested in us knowing Him. He's calling you to know Him. He's calling you, saying, will you come? Will you look at me? Will you sit at my feet? Will you establish your life at the foot of my ladder, at the foot of my coming, at the foot of my presence? Shall we bow our hearts before the Lord? Lord, I want to make fresh commitment to You that I want to live no place else but at the foot of Your ladder. And Lord, if I can climb up just a little bit higher to see You, if I can have hope and expectation in my heart that it really exists, then, oh God, my life changes and the purposes of my life change. I would sell everything I own to be able to just climb up the ladder just a little further. For an experience with You, You're our gate. And when You call us together in assembly, then You come and be in our midst. And it's Your house. So build Your house in us. Build Your house through us. But come and build Your house and be our gate that we could look up and see Your face. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 May God richly bless you.